Hey, buddy, it's your boy Franklin Crocker from the Franklin Crocker Show. In this episode, we have my brother from another mother, Omega Red. Yo, this dude has done some amazing things in the industry. We're talking about hip hop. We're talking about managing, producing, consulting. I mean, he's actually a musician. I mean, what don't you do? I should have went the other way. What don't you do?
What I don't do is sleep.
Dog, you got all the energy in the world, man. Welcome to my show, man.
Nah, it's an honor. I really appreciate it. It's a long time coming, man. I'm honored to be on your show, my brother.
Dog, yo, what's funny is you and I met probably about, I think it was the summertime.
Yep.
At a networking event.
Yep.
At the Rose. Yeah, at the Rose. And you and I hit it off really well. And then we found out we had a connection that was really dope. Mm-hmm. And the connection that we had, I'm going to play something a little real fast. Yo, Maestro, hit the button real fast for me. Let's go. I don't hear any music. Nope, I'm bopping, but I don't hear. I'm front like I hear something.
Really?
Okay.
Pause. I don't know.
Maybe you make it. Yeah, we're gonna keep popping. Because remember, we're gonna edit this anyway.
I'll put it in afterwards, but it should be
fine. Oh, you put it afterwards? Okay. Yeah. Nope. I'll do this when I'm just sounding like a.
Okay.
Rewind it. Can you rewind it? Let it run. Okay.
When I was younger, mother used to take me to church every Sunday. Told me God had a plan for me. Even though I didn't listen, get the olive oil. She had to put her hands on my head.
You know about the olive oil, right?
Yeah.
Count your blessings. I know you out in the streets being adolescent. Choir sing another hymn, words from the reverend. Subconscious stays in my cerebellum. Life, trials, tribulations. I come home past curfew, up waiting. I'm your only son, always going to be your baby. I'm so high in my eyes, look like Satan.
In the background.
You fix me your meal. You know that I'm hungry, tender, loving care. After the rainstorm, always comes a rainbow. I'm so thankful, I know you, my angel. Day when I was in the first grade, only shot. We had fun on the way, play games on the sidewalk. Balawab was a tough fuck. You lost one son to the streets. The pimp game put him in the ground 6 feet. Anything for your kids, no hesitation. You raise your kids, another generation.
Okay. Talk about my grandma over here.
Tribulations. Miss you so much, grandma, you were amazing. Everybody came to your house for a safe haven. First grandson told me that I was your favorite. Kidneys fail, dialysis made your body frail, and you passed away. After the rainstorm, always comes a rainbow. I'm so thankful, I know you, my angel.
Here we go, to the bridge. This is when you know. That's when you know when she hits this. When she hits this, that's when like, oh, that's not my song.
Oh, Donna.
When you're feeling
angel.
Down, when you're lost and blind, I can help you see. Make you believe.
This goes out to everybody who lost one and everybody who didn't realize they have one. It don't matter your faith or religion. We all one day gonna see the kingdom.
All right.
Had a feeling that should be your watch from a distance. Go to bed and dream, have visions. Guess what? It must be an angel.
Yo, fire, dog. Fire, yo. I listened to this song. So I was in the gym today.
Right.
And I probably played this song, I must call it, probably 4 to 5 times. And every time I played it, I heard something different in the song. And it, like you said before, it gave me that inspiration. And I thought, I made a comment a couple days ago when it was yesterday. I always do a throwback Thursday for my Uncle Frankie.
Right, right, right.
And at the end of my content, I put, thank you, Uncle Frankie. Keep looking over me. You're my angel. And then I play your song today. I'm like, yo, it's like, it's not by coincidence, man. Dog, this song is amazing, man.
Thank you. So the thing is, it's like, it's been kind of bittersweet. But when I actually sent her the record, and when we got started getting the studio to record it, she changed the lyrics up a little bit. She was just like, I'm going to say I'm going to be my angel watching over you.
Okay.
You know, but she knew she was sick and she was passing.
Ooh.
She knew. So it's like, oh, she's prophetic in that way. Got like, that's okay. That's how she is. Like, that record came to her in a time when she knew she was passing sick away. And she was gonna pass away.
Got it.
And she's like, I just want to switch this over. But she's like, you got the hit record. So me writing that record, like demoing and sending it to her, was like God sending her a message. Like, this is gonna be my last hurrah. This is the record. The last record she's on.
Oh my goodness! I didn't know. So you, how long ago after when you made the record did she pass?
She passed away 9 months after that.
Oh my goodness, man. So yeah. I can see why that's bittersweet now to you in that regards. And I remember Donna Summers being the queen of disco.
Pop icon.
I remember, I actually have a picture and I got to show you one day of her and my uncle.
You show me nothing crazy.
No. Her, my uncle, Donna Summers, my uncle was Frankie Crocker.
Yeah, yeah.
And you know, there's
a picture with them both.
Yeah, yeah. There's a couple, yeah. I got a couple pictures. Yeah, yeah. And you know, so it's dope to see, you know, we're following. I'm not saying following in footsteps, because I'm not gonna say the footsteps, but they laid a foundation out for both of us.
And we chose to go their path.
And it's a legacy. And it's funny because there's a song real fast. I'm just gonna sing a real quick line. It's from Hamilton. It says, my mother was a genius. My father commanded respect. But when they died, they left no instructions. It's a legacy to protect.
Mm.
And that's what we're doing right now. We're protecting a legacy that they passed on.
Yep.
And it's a great legacy. And again, I'm not following their footsteps, because we're doing it our different way.
Yeah, we have a passion. We're doing it our way. Yeah.
You know, because again, you know, you come up with, you know, because we're mastering social media, which they never had to deal with. They had to deal with their generation of how to become successful. And we're doing it our own way.
Right.
And it's great to have that legacy of, you know, of Adonis Summers in your background, man. And I can see a lot of it, dog. I mean, you are talented. I mean,
I really appreciate that.
Let's talk about the instruments you play, man.
So I play keyboards, you know, but my go-to instrument that I grew up honing was the saxophone. So, and I'm also a producer too. Like, you know, I know how to use the MPC and I know how to play chords and stuff like that. But my go-to was the saxophone. You know what I'm saying?
Sax? Mm-hmm. You ever, is there anything, did you start in high school? Did you start in like
grade? Yeah, I was in third grade.
Third grade. So you took it over. It was natural for you at that point.
Well, so it's a funny story. So I don't know, man. I just seen this saxophone on TV, man. I was just this young kid, man. I was a little kid. And it was just the most majestic thing I ever seen. Like, and I seen how women were reacting to.
I was going to say the same thing. Because, you know, I remember the cartoons. You get the little cartoons. You get the saxophone.
The women were like.
They love it.
Yeah. So, but I was just like, this is so majestic. I want to learn how to play this thing. And I guess my mother seen the look in my eyes where, like, oh, he really wants to play this.
That's dope.
And, you know, my pops was kind of like, oh, that boy don't want to play that thing. He just, you know.
He wastes my money.
Yeah, yeah, something like, you know what I mean? But then, though, I got the saxophone, and he said, I ain't going to lie, man. Like, one day I just came home from work, man. I heard you playing that thing out the window, man. I couldn't believe that was you, man.
That's dope.
Because I was starting to play stuff verbatim without learning how to read music yet.
Okay.
That's what I knew I had to get.
When you can do, and I've heard a lot about that similar person too, you know, and this is a great person to compare yourself to is Prince. You know,
yeah, Prince is a beast. Like, I'm not on that level.
No, but he learned, but it was all by ear. He didn't know. I mean, I don't think he even learned how to even write or read music, but the way he played these different instruments, like, it was like a natural talent at a very young age.
Mm-hmm.
And you seem to have that same talent.
Yep.
That's dope, man.
So as I, you know, when I got into school, you know, I started playing, you know, you had structure, you had band, and I did band for a while. Then I got into jazz band, and then I started doing marching band. So that brought me a lot of structure and learned how to play like classical music. I, you know, the range of music that I learned, you know, it was just my musical opus is very broad. So when people ask me like, who's your favorite artist? I'm like, that's going to be tough.
Because it depends. You have to break it down to almost a finite to figure out real, who it is.
Okay. Exactly. Because I listen to rock, opera, you know, Beethoven, funk, jazz, you know what I'm saying? Like, you know, I like disco still, you know, even though I was young, but, you know, in hip hop, you know, and it's just like, you know, sometimes I get shunned from the hip hop community because I'm a musician, you know what I'm saying? So they're like, yo, Red, just do this real hip hop. I'm like, I'm just like, what is real hip hop?
True.
Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, I'm a musician. Like, you trying to tell me to limit myself? And I realized a lot of them had limits, you know what I'm saying? And I didn't. So, you know.
And that's dope, like you said. And what shows in your personality, to me, I tell people all the time, it's like Rico. You are the company you keep.
Right.
But the same thing, you are the music you listen to. And by you telling me you like all those different genres of music, you're showing how open you are. And it shows people's personality.
Mm-hmm.
Because some people only listen to trap music. And
right.
You can see that in their personality.
And you can see it in everything surrounding them.
There's some people only listen to gospel. Not to say it's a bad thing, but you can see it in their personality. But when you listen to different genres of music, you have like, it's almost like different personalities in
different,
a sense.
Different personalities and different worldly views on things.
True.
Because like, you know, I'll be like the only dude at like an opera, like, you know what I'm saying, like an opera concert.
I went to a couple.
Country. I like country too. Like, what I find funny is the more white people I run into, they like, we don't like country. And I'm like, damn, for real?
And it's funny because you see more, because I mean, I grew up, not saying grew up listening to this person because my mother never played it, but I love Kenny Chesney.
Right.
And my favorite song by him is She Thinks My Tractor's Sexy. I love that song.
Right.
But people are like, yo, why do you, like, how do you know that? So I'm like, but I listen to all types of music.
Yes, that you're open to listen to everything. And I've always been that way. So, actually, it gives me an edge on a lot of things because I meet so many different people because of music. Music, I think math and music is universal. There's no way of getting around it.
True.
So I get, so me being in music and loving, appreciating other music, I get to get exposed to so many different other cultures on top of that. Like, I like Bollywood. You know what I'm saying? Like if you watch like a lot of Bollywood movies and dance joints, like they're crazy. You see the videos and how they structure and they do their thing. It's crazy.
It is a lot.
And their swagger is off the Richter.
True.
You know what I'm saying? If you like, you've seen some of the. It's like, and I take from those things. You know what I'm saying?
And you can pull from everything. And it goes to show also another thing about your personality, because you have a range of things that you listen to, and you're not pigeonholing yourself to one thing, that also shows into your business aspect. You don't put yourself in one box, man. Right. And I love that about you, dog. I'm gonna tell you that right now. I love that about
you. Appreciate
that,
fam.
You're not one of these people who say, okay, I'm only this. Mm-hmm. No, you're this. And as long as you put the passion into it, which you do, you're great at all those things.
Right. So what I've learned is, when I do start something, like a lot of people are like, oh, Robbie, you're into everything. I mean, I'm really not into everything. I'm good at a few specific things, but I'm open to learn about things.
Dope.
And that's what makes me that's what makes me different, that I'm not closed-minded. And a lot of people, when I moved here to Buffalo, a lot of people were like, you only can do one thing. And I'm just like, no, you that's not true. Like, you can do more than one thing. But I think a lot of people are used to people not wanting them to
do more
than one thing. Or people have tried to do more than one thing and failed. You know what I'm saying? And you can't look at it that way. Like, you're going to fail all the time. You know what I'm saying? So you got to just be persistent in whatever it is you want to do. And I've been showing a lot of people here, like a lot of people I've met through the years. I've been here almost 15 years now. I met a lot of people in business and networking and associates and friends. They came close to me to see that it's able to happen. So I've seen a lot of people transition into doing other things more than what they were just doing because they seen me do it. Right?
And that's a dope statement. Yeah. And it's funny you say that, because I just moved back to Buffalo about 2.5 years ago. And Buffalonians, we're a beautiful city, but we are stuck in, we're a one mindset town. And we don't try to take, and it's very tough when you come from, you said you came from somewhere else. We'll get into that. When you take something from somewhere else that's bigger than Buffalo and you bring it here, people don't know how to accept that.
Yeah, there's a lot of pushback.
Ton of pushback.
But what I realized though too, like, you gotta, I push back too, but you know, I kind of had to do like the Trojan horse type of situation. Like, I had to come in and act like I drank the Kool-Aid You know what I'm saying?
Sometimes you got to do that.
Yeah. Be part of different organizations and change things with inside the organization instead of like, you know, barking at everybody. Oh, y'all doing things the wrong way, this and that. And proving to them I actually genuinely cared about their organization and cared about the people. You know what I'm saying?
And they understand how genuine we are.
Yeah. So once they realized how genuine I was and I proved to them who I was, you know, some people, they kind of disappeared because they weren't who they say they were. And then the real ones, the real ones, they stuck around. Yep. You know what I'm saying? And be like, you know what, Rob? My bad. Like, I thought, you know, something different of you. You're not the person who I thought you were, you know? So
people can be very close-minded. And, right. You know, you said you moved here 15 years ago. And this is something else you and I have in common. Where are you from?
I'm from Boston, Massachusetts.
From Boston, Massachusetts. What neighborhood, Boston, Massachusetts? Dorchester. Dorchester. I grew up in
Dorchester, and then I went to junior high school in Randolph.
So I grew up. I lived in Boston for. I said Boston. I had this accent in Boston for for 2 years when I was a kid. I probably was like 7 or 8 years old.
Yeah.
And we stayed in Dorchester.
Right. Right.
I think it was Seaver Street.
Seaver Street, right around the way.
Yeah. So it's on Seaver Street. So we share that in common as well, which is pretty dope. Now I'm not a Bostonian. Like you are because you were, you know, you were born in this stuff there. But, you know, that's really dope. You and I have a lot of different connections in life in some of the same paths, which is really dope. Like I said, I don't look at life as just, you know, by coincidence.
Right.
It's a reason. I think God puts me in places and introduced me to people for a reason.
Yep.
And you and I, like I said, you know, I think we become very close over these past couple months.
Right, right.
In regards to our reason and our purpose. You have a very strong purpose. And I feed off of your energy. And, you know, sometimes I've always, you know, give other people energy. But I do feed off your energy because I see, dog, you're hustling, man.
I'm hustling, man.
You put in the effort into it. And right now, the lottery, I think the Mega Millions is $940 million. Mm-hmm. I tell people all the time, you know, people want to become millionaires overnight.
Right.
But in order to win that lottery, they're saying is you have to be in it to win it. You have to put the effort into it. You got to put your $2 in because you used to be a buck. You have to put your $2 in. To win that, and you're putting the effort in. So whatever your trajectory is that you're trying to get to, dog, you're gonna get there.
Yeah.
Because the effort is there. You're putting all the effort in. I know God is looking down on you like, yo, this in your aunt, yo, he's gonna bless him little by little.
So I've seen success. I know what it looks like. And so you know, I used to try to take a lot of shortcuts, but I've materialized a lot of things that my goals. So when I came here to Buffalo, I had a vision. You know, I wanted to offer my talents and my gifts and. I pretty much, you know, I'm living my vision, but, you know, different levels, different devils.
True story.
So, like, I'm still, you know, so I'm still progressing. I'm still evolving, you know, saying so, like, I still got goals, you know, and, you know, I need help from, you know, solid people to make your vision. You just can't do it all by yourself. Collaboration is key.
There's never been a millionaire or billionaire that did it by themselves.
Yep.
You need a team of like-mindedness. Hopefully that can help with your vision and not everybody. And it was crazy too, because I know you're similar to me. Not everybody always sees your vision.
Yeah. And I used to get upset about it. I ain't gonna lie. I used to get, you know, upset, but you know what? It's your vision. They can't see it.
It's not supposed not. I used to be the same way. And I thought about it this way. When you dream at night, nobody sees that dream.
No one sees
so it. You can't expect them to see what you are dreaming or. You may try to articulate it, but there's still that feeling that they can't feel.
Right.
Because you're attached to it, they're not. And I used to fall into that same issue as well. And I got myself out. I'm like, you know what? I can't expect people to understand my path. Because a lot of times, I may not understand their path, but I'm the type of person just like you. We try to look at other people in a different light. Okay, I'm trying to look at two different perspectives about one situation.
Yep.
Where some people are just like, oh, it's only this way and it only can be this way.
Yep.
No, there's multiple ways to skin a cat.
Yep.
And there's multiple ways to do things in life. And what you're doing right now, I really commend it because you're doing it your way. You have a legacy that you're fulfilling and you're taking the time to do it the right way. Like you said earlier, you may have sped up the process a little bit when you're, and we all do that, same way. But when it's your turn, it's your turn.
Right, right.
You know, you can't take that away from you.
Right. So, yeah, so that's what I'm doing right now. I'm just, you know, right now I'm in a stage in my life where, you know, I'm scaling, you know what I'm saying, with business and music.
Okay.
I'm going to be dropping a whole new album.
Dope.
New music. You know, a lot of stuff I've been putting out for the past year is like music that I didn't put out because I was, you know, so innated with, you know, help raising my daughter and then doing the music publishing. I've been doing a lot of music for music publishing where that was paying the bills, you know what I'm saying? So I got over 5,000 placements on TV and film.
Dope.
You know what I'm saying? We talked about the Black Lightning.
Yeah, yeah.
That was a big milestone for me getting doing the theme song for that. And then I got placements like all over, all types of, you know, like Bravo. Like, I mean, I got stuff on the Kardashian show. A ton of stuff on TV and film.
That's what I'm talking about. You working, man.
Yeah.
And again, that's very inspirational for somebody, especially here from Buffalo.
Yeah.
You're not from here, but you're a Buffalonian at this point. You're 15 years in. You're Buffalonian.
Yeah, I consider myself a Buffalonian.
Yeah, you're
now.
Buffalonian. And that's inspiring for this town, especially in this climate. Because a lot of, you know, past 9 months, there's a lot of bad things here that happen in Buffalo.
Yeah. Yeah.
and all you, like you said, all you can do is just say, yeah, because it's like, man, it's like, this town needs, this is a great town, but it needs some inspiring. These people like yourself that showing the world, okay, we're big, we're strong community. We're gonna come together when times like this happen.
And that's what I love. That's why I love Buffalo, man. Because like once they rock with you and they trust you, man, like you got them for life. You know what I'm saying? And you know, I'm not saying some of my people from back home are like that, but you know, I reached a peak, you know, back home where you know sometimes your dreams are so big that. Like, people just can't handle it. You know what I'm saying? They don't even know how to deal with you because they, you know, they just don't know how to support.
True.
You know, because, you know, you're on that grind, right? So I did a lot of shows, you know, and you know, I said, okay, I have to curate my own fan base. I just can't depend on my friends. Like, they would come when they could, though. Like, you know, but, you know, as you get older, you know what I'm saying?
Everybody got family, their own lives.
You know, yeah, you know what I mean? Yep. So, you know, but, you know, the camaraderie here, though, is really insane, and I really appreciate it. And people are like, oh, you like leaving Buffalo? I'm like, nah. Like, I built my business here. It's off the back of the collaborations I've had here in Buffalo, you know, and people are very loyal. Once they trust you and they believe you're generally here,
true.
They're loyal, and I'm that way. So I love it here, you know what I'm saying?
And it's a great networking town, hints to what you do as well, you know. Once you, like you said, once people know you, they're loyal to you here in Buffalo.
Mm-hmm.
And they'll rock with you thick and thin.
Mm-hmm.
Because Buffalo is one of those towns that everybody knows everybody. Like you talk about 6 degrees of separation in Buffalo, it's probably 1 or 2 degrees of separation,
yeah,
if that.
Sure.
Everybody knows everybody. And that's one of the powerful things about this town is people, when they do want to come together, they come together very well. We have our issues just like everybody else.
Yeah, everyone.
I said, you want to come, you heard what I said, you want to come together,
they
come together. But it's, again, it's still a mindset of everybody has to come together. But when those times happen, and it's sad because it's almost like a funeral, it's tough because a lot of people that come out of the woodworks when somebody dies, you see cousins and family that you've never seen before, and it shouldn't take somebody's death. Or some, it's just like right now, all the hardships we've had in Buffalo, it shouldn't take those things for us to come closer together.
So it's like, so it shouldn't take trauma.
Not at all.
People to come together, want to raise money. Like, it should be something that should be done all the time.
Well, just, you know, because it's the right thing
to do. For the cause.
Yes,
like,
correct.
Whatever the cause is, it shouldn't have to be a bad cause. Like, they should come together for the good causes, too. Or get behind somebody who's trying to better the culture, you know? So that's what I came here for, man. I wanted to come to a city that wasn't saturated. I lived in LA, I lived in New York City, I lived in Brooklyn before I came up here, and I'm from Boston, you know. So, and I traveled all through the United States, and so I wanted to come to a place where it wasn't as saturated. I could offer my gifts and my talents, and I can help people expand and grow and give them a different mindset. There's quite a few people that left Buffalo that I've definitely connected them with places, other places. And they start a whole new career there, and they're like, "Oh man, I feel like I'm indebted to you." I'm like, "Nah, man, that's just like, just keep me in mind, man. When you know something arises."
And it's funny because I said the same thing to you. It's like, I was like, "Yo, I owe you one." He was like, "You said the exact same thing. You know, just take care of me another." And that's the motto I go by too: is favor for favor.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm gonna help you out, you help me back out. You know, when I need your help, just hook me up as well.
Right,
so that's
exactly.
How, and that's how you grow. That's how you, hence what you
network,
do. That's how you network.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's what people do. Like, I know you've been connected to some big people here within the Buffalo area in hip hop, you know, I think with Ponzo, right?
Yeah, Ponzo, that's my meal. So Ponzo's my man. Like, you know, I met Ponzo at Kid Cole's spot, and he just got out. I mean, he was in the streets for a while, and he started his own business as well.
Yeah.
And we were like kind of like minded like that. I come from this, you know, like I come from the streets too.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, I just turned everything corporate, and we started working together, and I seen his hustle and his grind, and I told him, I said, "Yo, you're gonna make it." And he kind of looked at me crazy, like, "What?" I'm like, "You gonna make it." And I was like, I see your grind. Your grind like mine was when I first got into the music business. And then we just started doing music together. And then, you know, we became tighter and tighter. And then I just started connecting them, slowly connecting them with other things and giving them plugs. And, you know, we had him go to Boston, open up for Rick Ross. That was a huge milestone for him.
Huge.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? And then, you know, I just started plugging him with certain things. Like, what I, one thing about Ponzo, you give him a plug, he's going to the plug and he's doing it. Like, I don't got to force him to do anything. If it makes sense for him to do it, he's on it. And then you see the progression. That's how Ponzo is. Like, now he's acting, doing stuff. Like, you know what I mean? Like, that's my dude right there, man. I love Ponzo to death, man.
And that's dope, man. Again, that's the kind of friendship and the kind of business-minded people need to have.
Exactly.
Because that helps people grow. Again, you back somebody, they're backing you. Y'all help grow each other. Because, again, you're not going to see everything their way all the time. They're not going to see everything your way. Right. But when you have that synergy,
yep,
that energy coming together, y'all two like, you know what? And then you building something within that. Dog, you can't beat that, man.
Yeah, like, he took me on tour, like, you know what I mean? He put, like, he got the fire back inside of me because, like, you know, I didn't go on tour. I haven't been on tour in, like, you know, almost 25 years, you know what I'm saying? So he's like, yo, Red, come on tour with me. And it's like, you know, and it was a grueling tour. Like, we was on the road for 2 weeks. I was like, damn, I'm getting tired. So, like, he gave me that, like, fire back, yeah, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, that's what you gotta
do, man. So, you know, love you, Ponzo.
Yeah, man, that's what's up, man. And you know, my uncle has, I know your aunt has a saying too, and I wrote it down here, but my uncle has a saying as well. And the funny thing about it is, you know, he used to always tell me, sometimes people, you know, you have to grind to finally get there.
Mm-hmm.
But once you get there, you got to even grind even harder, yeah, to keep it.
Like I said, different levels, different devils.
To keep it.
Yeah.
Because sometimes we would just think, okay, I'm here now. No, you got to, in order to stay there.
Yeah, you got
to
sustain it. You got to sustain where you're at and then move up.
Then move up. You have to. And a lot of people don't have that mindset, and not just music industry, just in general, not just life as a whole.
Mm-hmm.
You got to keep grinding, and you're doing that, man. You are the epitome of that. You are grinding and grinding,
yep,
trying to keep going to that next level because you don't have a stop. You know, you just, you like the Energizer Buddy, dog. You keep going and going and going, man.
Yeah, I mean, I just grew up in a very extreme environment, man, for, like, to be successful. And it's like, it was, you know, I watched, like, so many people where I'm from become successful. Like, like, one of my high school buddies is DJ Clinton Sparks. I don't know if you heard of him, he's a world-renowned DJ. He worked with Akon. Like, he's produced a ton of stuff for, like, he discovered artists. Like, you look him up, you'll be like, okay. But yeah, I went to high school with Clinton. That's my man. Like, you know what I mean? And his grind, like, I watched him grind. Like, he was DJing for two radio stations. Like, he would DJ in Boston, then drive to Connecticut, and then fly to Maryland to do, like, three mix shows. You probably heard of his tag name, Get Familiar.
Okay, I heard it. Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
So that's him.
Okay, dope. Okay.
So, you know, like, I've been around people like that, you know what I'm saying? Like, you know, all my life, you know what I'm saying?
And that's dope.
You know, I came up on the underground scene with, like, Terminology, Crumb Snatch and all them. I just been around so much success. I just knew what the grind was like. It was a grueling, A lot of doors try to be shut in my face. So I had to, like, learn how to backdoor and make relationships with other people so I can get into that door. You know, it's like, if this dude's shutting me down, I'm gonna connect with, you know, that's where my networking skills
and
came
that's
from.
Where it came from. Yeah, you have to hustle like that, and that's really dope. So what do you see yourself, I guess, you know, what's your next goal right now? What are you trying to do?
My short-term goal right now is getting this album.
Okay. What album is that?
It's called The Red Tape Volume 4.
Okay.
So the last installation, Volume 3, that was hosted by DJ Chubby Chubb. I don't know if you know who he is.
I know Chubby Chubb, yep.
He's 50 Cent's DJ. Yep. So Chubb used to DJ for me when I used to do the Howard Homecoming shows.
Okay.
So so he did that last one. But this one's going to just be a album. And I got quite a few features for artists in Buffalo. Like, I'm trying to, like, put a lot of, you know, independent artists in Buffalo what I'm saying? So, I'm working on that. And then the clothing line, I'm going to really launch that. I got some pieces on, like, some ship dropping platforms just to test out to see what people like.
Okay.
But, I'm really going to push that because that's my, lifestyle brand.
Got it.
The Stay Grinding Clothing. So, you know, I want that brand to be a staple in, like, in my community and for what I stand for, my mission statement. You know, for it doesn't matter how big or small you are or your goals or your dreams, as long as you stay on your grind to accomplish them, you're part of the Stay Grinding movement.
That's what's up, man. That's a dope movement.
So those are my short-term goals right there. So, you know, I want to at least get my album out, you know, towards the end of the first quarter.
So in the first quarter. And how can people find you, man?
They can, all my social media is Omega Red Superfan. That is so you spell Omega Red, but Superfan is spelled a little different. It's S-U-P-A-F-A-N.
Okay.
And then my website's just OmegaRedSuperfan.com. So all my social media handles is Omega Red Superfan. Holler at me, I'll get right back at you.
Yo, this is my boy right here. Show him some love. Omega Red, my man, 50 grand. Yo, I really appreciate you being on the show today, man.
Honor, man. Dog,
this is, yo, we've been talking about this for a while.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And guess what? This ain't going to be our last joint.
Nah, I was just saying.
We're going to have some other topics we're going to talk about. Right. We're going to really get busy, man, and I really appreciate you, dog.
Yeah, I appreciate you, bro.
Man, we'll keep doing this. This is the Franklin Crocker Show. Remember, this is the show that helps you to hear music differently. Ooh, let's get it.